Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
Our Father, we give you thanks that you are doing a thing in our time. A great work is beginning in our time. We give you praise, O God, that you have gathered us, women from different parts of Southern African sub-region especially. We are grateful that your eyes are upon us. You have something that you have for us ahead of time, because the reign of revival is coming and you don't want it to stop us. We thank you for bringing us into this meeting. We thank you, we give you praise that you are the Lord of all. You are the Lord of the universe. You have your timing for everything that you want to do on the face of the earth. And you are ringing the alarm in our hearts that it is time for you to visit the church and the nations of the Southern African sub-region. We give you praise, O God, that you have remembered us. We are grateful to you that despite all the evils in our nations, you have decided that you want to visit us. We are very grateful, Lord. We are very grateful. Receive our thanks in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we commit ourselves to you. You are the Alpha, you are the Omega. You are the Lord who decided to do this in our midst in a way that surprised us this time. That you are gathering us together. Though we are few and feeble, yet you rejoice in using feeble people. We thank you. And as we start this meeting, you are the Alpha, you are the Omega. We ask of you, O God, that you will come into our midst. You will gather with us. You will come, O God, and bless us. You will come, O Lord, and grant us a divine encounter. That nobody will leave this place, O God, without the touch of the Holy Spirit. Do us good, O God. Cause your presence to overwhelm each one of us. Cause every woman here to see as you see. That, Lord, we may launch ourselves and plunge ourselves into your purpose. In the name of Jesus Christ. We stand before you and pray that you will come to us and release your word to us. Utter your voice and cause us to hear you. When you speak, the earth trembles. When you speak, the blind see. The lame walk and leap for joy at the sound of your voice. When you speak, O God, the dead arise from their graves. When you speak, the blind see, the mute speak. The dumb speak. Father, we ask of you that you will utter your voice and cause us to hear you and to understand you and to live for joy for what you are beginning to do in our nations. Do it for us, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, because you are the Lord. You are the Lord of the universe, and to you every knee shall bow. So we command every demon, every principality, every power, every gate of hell that want to stand against us and against your purpose in our midst in this CLR, we command you to bow in the name of Jesus Christ. We bind every principality, every power, every prince of darkness in the nations. We declare to you that the Lord has arisen to answer the cry of our hearts. Where are you? We bind you and we cast you out of the way in the name of Jesus Christ. We declare every gift. asunder. In the name of Jesus Christ, let the people of the Lord go free to serve the living God. We stand therefore and declare this meeting open in the name of Jesus Christ. So Lord, have your way. Have your liberty, Father. Take over this meeting in every center. Take over every heart, oh God, we hand over to you. You are the Lord who has the key. Father, take over. Have your way, do what you please. We hand over to you the keys of the nations of the South African sub-region. We hand over to you, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Take over. Take your place in our lives. Take your place in our nations. And let your name alone be exalted. We worship you, Father. We hand over to you and we give you all the glory. Thank you, Father, for hearing us. For we have prayed in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The theme of our meeting is come, let us build. Come, let us build. And it is taken from the book of Nehemiah, Nehemiah chapter 2, 17 to 20. Then I said to them, you see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lies waste, and its gates are burned with fire. Come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem, that we may no longer be a reproach. And I told them of the hand of my God which had been good upon me, and also of the king's words that he had spoken to me. So they said, let us rise up and build. Then they set their hands to do this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard of it, they laughed us to scorn and despised us and said, what is this thing that you are doing? Would you rebel against the king? So I answered them and said to them, the king of heaven himself will prosper us. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build. But you have no heritage or right or memorial in Jerusalem. It is very clear that the Lord has come to prompt us to begin to play our role as women in the South African sub-region. The Lord himself has been saying to us over the past few years that he has arisen to help to hear Zion. He has arisen. The set time to help us has come. And we thank God that we as women, we have decided by the grace of God to take the bull by the horn and arise with our God to build our Jerusalems, our nations. Because surely you can see that we are in ruins. Our nations are in ruins. Things are happening that we cannot start talking about now, but we will surely look into some of them in the course of this meeting. You see the reproach that has befallen the Southern African nations is quite a reproach indeed. But we are thanking God that he has decided to call us as women, to call us to arise and do the fundamentals so that our men will have something to nurse. If a mother does not deliver a baby, men have nothing to nurse. They have no child to nurse. So we are the ones that God comes to first to begin to do something before he will actually visit any nation. So we are trusting God that by the end of this meeting, God would have got women who will take the bull by the horn to arise to build the nations where we are in, to build the church in our nations, to build the old wasted places, the old ruins in the body of Christ in our nations. You know that there are some ruins that have happened to us over the years. There are some concepts that have been bastardized. There are some things that even our children, they don't know the meaning of it in the scriptures any longer. We have been called of God to arise. We are the ones that God is visiting first to arise and to build. So we are expecting that as women in the South African sub-region, by the end of this meeting, we will rise up to build the old wasted places. We will rise up to build in the church all the godly concepts, the godly virtues that have been lost in the church. You will arise to begin to build it again so that the Lord will visit our nations. Because when the Lord wants to visit a nation, He doesn't just visit the nation, He first visits the church. He visits the church in revival. And you will, if you know the story of revivals in the developed nations, you will discover that it was God's visitation to the church that brought the building of those great nations. It was in the time of revival that United Kingdom, Britain, was built. It was in the time of revival that United States of America was built. And all the development we are seeing today, even in science, came as a result of revival. So God wants to visit Southern African nations. And He will start with the church. And in the church, He will start with women. So this night, as we look at Come, Let Us Build, we're going to be considering the woman God uses. The woman that God will use to build the church in any nation, to begin the building. The woman God will use to build the nation in different aspects of human endeavor. Women have a great role to play. So we are going to consider the woman God uses. And I'm praying that as we look into this aspect of our meeting, the Lord will come down and bless us. Each one of us, we will become a woman that God will use. Whether you are young or you are old, there is nobody that God wants to exempt. You will become a vessel in God's hands that He will use in the days to come to start a great move of God, a revival in the church and the building, the rebuilding of our nations. May the Lord hear our cry in the name of Jesus Christ. As I said before, women are very crucial in revival. Women are very crucial in God's work upon the face of the earth. Women are very important. Most of the time, when He wants to visit the church in revival, He visits the women. Of course, when the story of revival in the nations will be told, it is the arrowheads, the men who are the arrowheads in that revival that are often talked about. But never mind, a woman must be under before the men will be able to arise. As I go through the stories of revival, I saw that women were fundamental in revival. There were women who first carried the burden, the fire of revival, the burden of it in the wombs of their hearts until something is born and the fire is kindled and then the men can run with it. Women are oftentimes quietly behind every revival. God first visits a woman in order to visit the church. He first visits a woman in order to visit the nation. And so it's not a strange thing that God is calling us in the nations of Southern Africa to prepare us for what he has ahead of us. Because he must of a necessity visit the woman first. Even if it's one woman in a nation, it's enough to kindle the fire of revival. And we are more than one here. So God is calling on us because he must visit us first before any revival will be born in our churches and in the nation. You will remember that the children of Israel suffered for many years, in fact, hundreds of years in Egypt. And they were afflicted very terribly for hundreds of years until the Lord found a Jochebed who will bring forth the deliverer. And it was not just Moses. The life of Jochebed challenged me a lot. That this woman had three children, and all her three children were the basic three that God used to bring the nation of Israel to birth. Israel was getting lost in Egypt. But by the hands of these three children of Jochebed, the Bible says God delivered Israel, the Jews, from Egypt by the hands of Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Those three, the Lord used them, but a woman gave birth to them. And this woman was so devoted to God that he did not fear the wrath of the king, the command of the king. Hebrews 11 tells us that even though the king made a command that they should kill all the sons of the Jews, this woman delivered a boy at such a very terrible situation. Of course, by that time, Aaron was already born. Miriam was already born. So they couldn't kill those ones. But Moses was born at the heart of that command that they should kill all the sons, all the boys that were born in that time of distress. But this woman took her life by her hands and said, "This, my son Moses, will not die." And she devised all kinds of means to keep that boy alive. She devoted her time to keep that child alive. They saw that this one, there is something special about this one. This one will not die by the hand of King Pharaoh. And God preserved that boy. We are talking about the nation of Israel today because God found a Jochebed who brought forth a Moses who delivered Israel from Egypt. A woman who did not fear the wrath of the king, a woman who was so devoted to God, who feared God, whose heart was loyal to the Lord. And no matter what the king threatened, she would not be afraid. God is looking for such women even today, so that our nations will receive a visitation from on high. Manoah's wife is another woman. That woman, you also know that it was a time of distress in Israel when they were under the bondage of their enemies, that this woman was barren. But you see, I saw something. It's not their children I will want to talk about, but these women themselves. That this Manoah's wife, you will always read about her, that she went to the field and then the angel came and met her. She went to the field. What was she doing on the field? It's not to farm. She went there to encounter God. She went there, her heart was towards the Lord. She went there to meditate. She went there to be with God. Because, you see, the Lord could have met her in her house. But it was as she went out on the field alone with God that the Lord met her. So it was then that the angel came and announced the birth of Samson, who would deliver the children of Israel from the hands of the Philistines. Such women that God will use will be women who know how to walk with God. Women who are committed to the Lord. Women who are loyal to God, come what may. He
in their situation of difficulty, they remain loyal to the Lord. Manoah's wife was loyal to the Lord. She was always seeking the face of the Lord. No wonder God visited her, and by her, God visited the nation. What will I say about Esther? Just for us to peruse these women, later we may study them deeply. But look at Esther, a young lady. She was not old, just a young queen. A young queen that the Lord saw ahead of time and sent into that kingdom in Babylon, ahead of what God saw that would become a trouble to the Jews. God saw ahead that at a time there will be a Haman that will vow to destroy all the Jews. And he went and got a girl, a woman, a young lady. A young lady who had prepared herself, who had been discipled by her senior cousin, Mordecai. A young lady who kept herself pure. A young lady who was committed to Christ and to the cause of Christ, the kingdom of God upon the face of the earth. A young lady who feared God. A young lady who could fast in the midst of plenty. A committed young lady. When we are looking for the woman God will use, Esther stands to us today. The story of Esther stands to teach us a lesson. Esther, as she was entering into that palace, she entered as a virgin. These are days when young ladies don't count virginity as anything. But up till today, up till tomorrow, God still values virgins. And I dare say that there are certain things God will do upon the earth. And the only people that will be qualified will be virgins. I mean even physical virgins. And I challenge our young ladies in this meeting tonight. Keep your virginity, the Lord has laid of it. You never can tell. You know, when the Lord was about to find somebody to bring forth the Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, it has been prophesied before that a virgin will conceive. No young lady who was not a virgin could be qualified at that time for such a great prophecy to bring something great upon the face of the earth. So when you are looking for a woman that God will use, it's in every aspect of life that such a woman must be pure. Pure at heart, committed to the Lord, loyal to the Master, and to the kingdom of God. Such was Esther. No wonder God found her a woman that he will use to deliver the Jews from the hands of the enemy Haman. God found Esther. God found Mary. God found Elizabeth. Oh, Elizabeth. That aged woman. Some people say, I'm old. Can God still use me? Look at Elizabeth, aged. And the Bible talks about them in Luke chapter 1, verse 6, that both herself and her husband were blameless before the Lord. What kind of old woman would this be? Very aged. And yet, they were blameless. In verse 6, he said, let me read from verse 5. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias of the division of Abijah. His wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. God is looking for a woman whom he will use, but you can see the qualifications here. And you dare not say it's not possible. Look, there were women even at such times that God found who have not bowed their knees to Baal. 7,000 reserved by God. There were people, even if the Elijahs of today are saying we are the only ones, the Lord says, I have reserved for myself. May you be one of those reserves in the name of Jesus Christ. Look at this aged woman that God had to find to bring to birth the forerunner of our Lord Jesus Christ. She was a woman, aged as she was, young as Esther was, barren as Manoah's wife was, and Jochebed of the childbearing age. All of them were found by God at a time when the nation needed the visitation of God most. They were women who were loyal to the Lord. They were women who were committed to the cause of Christ. And you see, the Bible says in 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9, it says, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro all over the earth, that he might prove himself mighty on behalf of those whose hearts are loyal to him. You will discover that each of these women we have talked about, their hearts were loyal to the Lord. They were committed to the Lord. Even if 1,000 women were doing evil in their time, they were committed to the cause of Christ. They were committed to God up to the point of losing their lives if need be. Esther said, if I perish, I perish. That such was their commitment. And God is looking for such people who are committed to him, who are committed to the cause of the kingdom. Women who are kingdom-minded that he will raise to use in order to visit the church and to visit the nation. We are praying that by the end of this meeting, God would have laid his hands on you. You will be one of such women that God will say, in South Africa, I have a woman there. In Namibia, I have a woman there. Just one is enough. And if you are two or three, oh, the better. May you be so committed, may you be found committed as the Lord will be dealing with us in this meeting. And God will not say, I have found no one. I look for a woman from among them and I found none. May that not be your lot in the name of Jesus Christ. God is looking for women who are pure at heart. God is looking for women whose hearts are blameless, who could walk with God blamelessly. Not women who are convinced that nobody could be blameless. Nobody could, you know, nobody could be pure before God. That's a devilish conviction. If you trust in God, it can make you blameless, as he made Elizabeth, even at that time when there was no grace. We are at a time when divine enablement, grace, has been poured forth, and we will be able to walk with God blamelessly. Why don't you use that opportunity? The woman that God will use must be a woman who is pure at heart. A woman walking blamelessly before God. A woman whose heart is committed, loyal to the cause of Christ. Such is a woman that God is looking for. As God wants to visit the South African nations again, he is looking for such a woman. Pure, blameless, barren. Though he may be barren, but he will make such a woman fruitful as he did to all the women we have talked about. He is looking for such a woman who will bear the burden of revival, the burden of the nation in her heart, who will bear that burden before the Lord until the visitation of God is born. He is looking for such a woman. Since it is in times of revival that the building of a nation is done, then we need a revival. If there is anything the nations of Southern African sub-region needs, it is revival. We need God's divine visitation. And God is looking for women who will spark up that revival, whom he will use to do something eternal in our time, so that What God has been planning for ages to do in our nations, He will succeed in doing it by our lives in the name of Jesus Christ. But you see, as we looked at these women very briefly, you will see again that the condition of their heart was what God saw in order to use them. Each of them. God did not miss words about the condition of their heart. God opened it up. The one that is pure, the one that is blameless, He said it. So it is the condition of a woman's heart that will make God either to use her or to reject her. The woman God will use must prepare her heart before the Lord as a woman whose heart is loyal to the Lord, a woman whose heart is pure and blameless before Him. You will remember 1 Samuel chapter 16, 1 Samuel 16, verses 6 and 7, when the Lord went to send Samuel to anoint David in the house of Jesse. 1 Samuel 16, 6 and 7. So it was when they came that he looked at Eliab and said, "Surely the Lord's anointed is before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look at his appearance or at his height of his stature, at the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord doth not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." The Lord looks at the heart. Before God will use a woman, He looks at the heart. So the heart of the matter is your heart. If God is going to use you as a woman to build the church, to build your nation, He will look at your heart. And the Second Chronicles that I quoted before said that the eyes of the Lord, I'd like us to read that scripture, 2 Chronicles 16, verse 9. "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him." Let me stop there. The second aspect of it, we will look at it at the end of this meeting. The Lord's eyes are going to and fro, up and down, throughout the whole earth, looking for someone. Looking for someone. You see, power is in heaven. There is enough power in heaven to overrun the earth. But He must connect with a man or a woman on the face of the earth in order to bring the power down. He is looking to and fro all over the earth. His eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole earth, including Namibia, including Botswana, Eswatini, including South Africa, including Malawi, Zambia, Zimbabwe. God's eyes, even as I'm talking, is going around, to and fro all over that nation, looking for someone whose heart is loyal, committed to Him, come what may, so that He will show His power in helping them. Even Bible says so. So that He will prove Himself mighty on their behalf. It is the heart that shows whom God will use. It is a man's heart, the Bible says, that shows who he is. It is your heart that will either reject you before the Lord or choose you. So it is the heart that God is looking at. And my challenge tonight is, should God look into your heart tonight, what will he see? When he looked into Eliab's heart in that 1 Samuel chapter 16, the Lord stop Samuel from anointing Elia. May the Lord not stop from anointing you in this meeting. May you not be rejected of the Lord. The Lord shouted all the way from heaven, don't look at his appearance. Don't look at the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as a man sees. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. If the Lord should peep into your heart today, my sister, what will he see? What will he see? In Genesis chapter 6, verse 5, the Lord peeped at the hearts of people on the earth that time. Let's see what he saw. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. What did God see in that time? He saw wickedness. If God should peep into your heart tonight, my sister, what will he see? Is it not wickedness he will see? Are you wicked in your actions? Are you so wicked? And the Bible says he saw that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was evil continually. All the day, throughout the day, evil. What are you thinking about? Are there some times of the day that your heart thinks evil? Have you imbibed pornography so much that if you belch, you belch pornography? Are you so evil in your thoughts that it's only wickedness that the Lord sees inside? It's impurity of every kind that he sees inside. Let's look at another scripture to see what the Lord, saw in somebody. And in fact, the result of that person was that God killed him. God killed him straight away and killed his wife. In Acts 5 verse 3. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and keep back part of the price of the land for yourself? While it remained, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not your own control, in your own control? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You have not lied to man, to men, but to God. Then Ananias, hearing this words, fell down and breathed his last. So great fear came upon all those who had these things. Can you see what the Lord saw in the heart of Ananias? And the wife story is down that chapter. Can you see what the Lord saw? Peter was so afraid of him. Peter was so surprised that a child of God like Ananias, one of the disciples, and his wife Sapphira, Satan could fill him with lies. His heart was not full of the Holy Ghost, but full of lies. The wife Sapphira could conceive lies with the blink of an eye. My sister, is that your situation? If the Lord should peep into your heart, what will he see? Are you such a liar that you can conceive lies without thinking, my sister, and yet you are born again? How do you want the Lord to use you that way? Ananias and Sapphira's heart were full of lies. You may not be full of lies. Yours must be sexual, may be sexual immorality, even as you carry born again on your head like a placard. Are you are you full of sexual immorality, impure thoughts, different kinds of evil in different hearts, and you are shouting hallelujah, praise the Lord in the midst of God's people, my sister. If you are hoping to be a vessel in God's hands, a woman that God will use at a time like this when he has arisen to visit Zion, then something must happen to your heart. God must have to do something to your heart. And you can be a vessel, you know. You are a potential in God's hands. You can be a vessel, but something must happen to your heart. If the Lord should peep into your heart, what will he see? Let's look at another scripture to see what God saw in many people's hearts that the Lord could, you know, list it so eloquently in the scriptures. Mark chapter 7, verses 20 to 23. And he said, what comes out of a man, that defiles a man. For from within, out of the heart of men, out of the heart of men proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile a man. These are things that will not allow God to use you. Look at this terrible list that the Lord Jesus Christ brought forth. He said, look, what defiles a man that makes such a man or a woman unusable to God are things from within the heart. That's why we are concentrating on the heart this night. Because if we are going to present our lives to God as women that God will use to build in the church, to build in our nations, then something must happen to our hearts. He said, what comes out of a man's heart, that's what defiles him. And here is the list. Here is one of the lists. He said, evil thoughts. Do you think evil about another woman? Do you wish your enemies to die? Don't you pray that your enemies should fall down and die? Woman of God, when Jesus says in Luke chapter 9, the Son of Man did not come to destroy lives, but to save them. But you are busy using the name of Jesus to destroy lives. Are you doing well? Evil thoughts, adulteries, and it amazed me that he put it as plural, which means there are so many kinds of adulteries and fornications, different kinds, more than you ever knew. Adulteries, fornications, all those sodomites, all those lesbians, homosexuals, all those LGBT people, adulteries, fornications, evil thoughts, perverse minds. These are things that when God sees inside a heart, he will not use you. You will not see the glory of God. The Bible says, blessed are the pure in heart, they shall see God. You will not see God. You won't be able to see God in action through your life. You may be praying. You may be going to church and singing like an angel, but you will not see God. You will not see his glory. You will not see him act on your behalf. Only the pure in heart he will use. Adulteries, fornications, murders. And you see, it's one thing to kill with sword and kill with guns and with cudgel. But it's another thing to kill with hatred, to kill with anger. The Bible says anybody who hates his brother is a murderer, just as Cain hated his brother. Anything hatred, anything anger, wrath, that makes you to do evil against your brother or your sister, you are already a murderer. A murderer at heart. So if God should look into your heart tonight, my sister, will he see murder? Is there a sister you hate? Is there a brother you cannot see eye to eye? Is there a man somewhere, maybe even your husband, that you hate so much because of what he has done to you? And you are not praying for his salvation. You are praying that he will perish. And you are saying God should use you. My sister, God is looking for women to use. But he will not use a woman with hatred in her heart, with bitterness in her heart, a woman who is a murderer. Thefts. Do you steal craftily? You may not be an armed robber breaking houses, but you know how you steal. You steal at work. You use crafty means to append your signature, to dupe government, to defraud people. You steal. And he talks about thefts, again, plural, thefts. You know what you are stealing. You know how you are stealing. And God is saying, if I see that in your heart, how will I use you? For the Lord is looking for people whose hearts are pure, blameless, loyal, committed unto him and to his righteousness. Covetousness. Oh, women, covetousness. You can't do without buying what your eye sees. You covet. You will borrow to buy something that appeals to your eyes. If you don't have money for it, you will borrow. Are you covetous? It is in your heart, and God has looked inside tonight and is saying, how will I use you? I want to use you, but that thing in your heart will not allow me. Will you please do without that tonight and cry to God to do something about this, your heart? He says, covetousness is what defiles a man. Wickedness, deceit, lies, telling lies, deceiving people. Deceiving people. Even on the pulpit, you are a woman of God, so to say. But you deceive people on the pulpit just to collect the money in their pockets. You tell a story that is not there. You deceive. And when God sees that, he said, you are out of the way. God will not anoint you. Just as he pushed Eliab aside, so he will push you aside. Licentiousness, all those kinds of evil things, evil behaviors, immoral filthy behaviors, evil eye, blasphemy, insulting people, insults upon people. Anybody that dares to offend you, you can insult. God is saying, if I see that in your heart, even before you commit that thing, I cannot use you. Blasphemy, pride. Pride, my sister. Those who have substance, they are proud. Even those who don't have, they are proud of what they don't have. Can you imagine the irony of the issue? What are you proud of, my sister? Some are proud even of the grace of God manifesting in their lives, forgetting that there is nothing we have that we have not received. And if we have received them, why do we boast? Are you proud of what you have? Are you proud of the grace of God in your life? Are you proud because you are rich or you are educated? This arrogance is what will make God to set you aside on the shelf. and he will not come near you when it comes to the time of divine usefulness. Pride and foolishness. Hey, go and read the book of Proverbs. You will see the foolishness of the foolish. So many things that God talks about that makes a woman foolish. And God says, when I see foolishness in your heart, I will not use you. You're going to be praying tonight. It is the heart that God is looking at before he will choose you to use you. All the women of old that the Lord used, he looked into their hearts and he commented, Elizabeth was blameless in all the commandments of God. She was obedient to God, come what may. Esther was obedient even to the point of saying, if I perish, I perish. And she kept herself pure before the Lord. Tonight is your heart. It's our hearts that God is looking at. As we begin this meeting tonight, should God peep into your heart, what will he see? What will he see? Will he see any of these rotten things? Will you please pray with me tonight and call on the Lord to take away this your heart? In fact, he says in the book of Proverbs, chapter 23, Proverbs 23, verse 26, he says, my son, and tonight my daughter, give me your heart and let your eyes observe my ways. Give me your heart. You can't improve it. You pray and make New Year resolution. Lord, I won't do it again, Lord, but you know I won't do it again. I won't do it again. God says you will do it again. Give me your heart. I'm going to change it for you. That will be the solution. Give me your heart. My sister, God is saying, give me your heart. Just give me that heart. Don't say, Lord, I will improve. You cannot improve it. A leopard cannot change his skin. You cannot improve your natural heart. You were born with that wicked heart. Give me your heart, says the Lord. And in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, God tells us what he will do with that heart. Ezekiel 36, 25 to 27. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you will keep my judgments and do them. The ability to walk with God blamelessly only comes as the Lord takes away that evil heart, that sinful heart. God is saying, give me your heart, then I will give you a new heart. There's an exchange that God wants to give you tonight. And he says, I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. All your filthiness of the past, the blood of Jesus will flow tonight to cleanse you from them all. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. And I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. But I will not only cleanse you, because if I only cleanse you, your evil heart will still produce evil as you go away from here. He says, I'm going to take away from you the heart of stone. I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you. There will be an exchange. That's what God wants to do tonight. Don't keep struggling. Don't keep trying. Tonight, it is your heart that God is dealing with. He says, my daughter, give me your heart and I will give you a new heart. Give me your heart and I will take away that stony heart and give you a new heart. You know, Jesus did something in the Gospels, in the book of Matthew chapter 21. Because you see, your heart is where God wants to dwell, to do his work of building the church, building the nation. When he says, I will build my church, he wants to live inside of you to build his church. It is our heart that he wants to stay in to begin to work. When he gives you a new heart, he himself comes in and makes you his dwelling place. In the book of Matthew chapter 21, when Jesus went to the temple, you know what he did. He saw in the temple that evil going on in the temple. He saw people buying and selling doves, exchanging money with all the change. He saw people buying and selling sheep. He saw people, and you see, there was the smell of goat dung, cow dung, everywhere around the temple of God. And your heart is the temple that he wants to dwell in. Every defilement that is inside, he wants to deal with it as he dealt with it that day. The Bible says, when he saw those selling doves, those who were exchanging money, as it is even today, people are doing money business in the name of prosperity in the church. They are selling doves. They are selling anointed handkerchiefs. All those kinds of people, the Lord has arisen tonight. And from tonight, he will change them out in the name of Jesus Christ. He made a whip of cords. He wove them together and went to those people that were buying and selling in the temple of the Most High God. He drove them out. He gave them thorough lashes and drove them out and overturned their tables and cleansed his temple. Thereafter, in verse 14 of that scripture, the Bible says that Jesus sat down in the temple, and then the lame, the blind, they began to come to him there, and he gave them their healing. That's what God wants to do in your heart. He wants to sit there and do miracles and reach out to people and build his church, build the old ruins, build what was lost, recover the lost through your heart as he sits there. He wants to stay inside of you, but he can't stay in the old heart, the natural heart, that evil heart, that sinful heart. He must take away that heart of stone tonight and give you a new heart. And he himself will come and make your heart his dwelling place. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 16 says, and what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God and they shall be my people. You can see that God wants to dwell in you, but now there is no space. Those sinful habits, they have occupied the place. But tonight, he is here with a whip of cords. He's going to drive away all those buying and selling, all those evil activities going on in your heart. He's going to drive them out and cleanse you. And then he will take away that evil heart. And in exchange, he will give you a new heart. And as many as are ready tonight, as are ready for that new heart, the heart, the kind that Mary had, the kind that Manoah's wife had, that made her to always love the presence of God, the kind that Elizabeth had, the kind that Jochebed had, and she was as bold as a lion, she did not fear the wrath of the king. That kind of heart God wants to give you tonight. God wants to give you tonight. And you cannot reject it. He died for you for that sake, so that you can have that heart. That's why he went all the way to Calvary, so that you can have access to what can make a difference in your life. Before, there is no such access. But when Jesus went all the way to Calvary, and he took our old man, our sinful to the cross and he died with it there. Then we have liberty now to collect the new heart. Would you like to pray with me tonight? I say, Lord, I want to be a vessel in your hand, but for my heart. As you are looking into my heart, I cannot say I am pure before you. Lord, take away this evil heart. Cleanse me from all my filthiness. Give me a new heart. Come and make your dwelling place in my heart. The Lord is looking for someone to use, especially a woman, at a time he wants to begin the move of the Spirit in your nation. And you see, if he finds you, something speedy will happen in the nation where you are. He will begin to work because he has found a woman who will carry such a heart that can birth revival. A heart where he will dwell to do something new in the church in your nation. Will you say to God tonight and say, Lord, I'm here. I cannot hide it from you. My heart is not clean. My heart is not blameless. Though I say I'm born again, I cannot claim that I'm pure before you. Will you please, Lord, take away this evil heart? Exchange it with the new heart that you promised in the book of Ezekiel to give me. I need it, Lord, I need it. Wherever you are tonight, I would like you to stand on your feet as we raise this cry to heaven and say, Father, I'm here before you. How will I hide my heart from you? You see me inside out. You know every cell in my body. You know what is going on in my heart. I cannot hide it from you. But tonight I come just as I am. Take away this evil heart, O Lord. Give me a new heart as you have promised. On the day you are coming to get women that you can use, may you not find me with that evil heart. Take it out of the way, Lord. Will you please pray as you are standing on your feet tonight? Sisters, please pray. Tonight will mark the night that you have been looking for. Tonight, something will begin with you. And God himself will be personal with you. Will you call on him and say, Lord, I cannot hide it. Take away this evil heart from me. Make me a woman that you can use. Make me a woman that as your eyes are running to and fro over the nations of Southern Africa, I will be a woman that you will find usable. Make me such a woman tonight. As you look inside my heart, please cleanse me. I cannot claim that I'm blameless. But Lord, forgive me. Take away from me, Lord, this evil and sinful heart. This thing that has defiled me. You know that thing. You know that defilement, my sister. Please pray right now. And say, Lord, take away this defilement from me. Lord, please cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Lord, cleanse me. Please pray. Talk to God. Don't let your heart deceive you. Because that would be a deceit again to say, but I'm born again. You are born again. When did you get that deceptive heart? When did you get that heart that is wicked? Where did you get that heart that thinks evil continually? Where did you get it? Will you pray tonight, Lord, I cannot hide it from you. Please have mercy on me. Give me a new heart. Give me a new heart. I come to you tonight, Lord. You died on the cross for me to give me that new heart. You paid the price for me to get that new heart. How will I reject that heart that you want to give me tonight when you have paid for it dearly on the cross? Give me a new heart. Give me a new heart. Give me a new heart. Change my heart, oh God. Make me ever new. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh Lord. Take away this evil heart. Take it out of the way. I don't want to hide it from you. Give me a new heart, Lord. I receive it from you tonight. And if you are making that decision, something eternal will begin with you tonight. As you are making that decision, Would you like to lift up your two hands to heaven and say, Lord, I'm the one? Identify yourself before the Lord. Don't hide it. The Bible says, anyone who hides his sin shall not prosper. But he who confesses and forsakes it shall obtain mercy. Tonight, don't hide it. Lift up your two hands, my sister. God bless you. Yes. Wherever you are, please lift it to heaven. And say, Lord, I'm the one. How can I hide it from you? You know me inside out. You knew earlier. Though he did emergency sanctification in the day of divine usefulness, God saw his heart and said, put away this one. I have rejected him. Put away this one. I have rejected him. And tonight God is saying, I don't want to reject you, but why will you hide it? Lift up those hands. Yes, my sisters. Thank you. God bless you. In every center, the Lord is calling on you. You are the one my eyes are upon. Why will you hide it? Why will you hide your sin? Why will you hide that evil heart when you know it is happening inside your heart? Where will you hide it? Thank you. All those who lifted up their hands, will you please come to the altar to meet the Lord? It is your Lord that is calling you. He said, come to me. I will give you rest. Come to me. I will take away that heart of stone and give you the heart of flesh. Yes, my sister. God bless you. Please come out to the altar. It is the Lord calling on you. Come to me. Thank you. Thank you. Please come out. Come out and let the Lord himself do that miracle of exchange tonight. I say, Lord, I'm the one. I'm the one in need of a new heart. I'm the one in need of you. Lord, I don't want to hide my sin and go away with this evil heart. Lord, please have mercy on me. Change my heart, oh Lord. Make it new. Give me a new heart. Give me a new spirit. I'm sorry, Lord, for the wickedness of my heart. I'm sorry, Lord. Have mercy upon me. Let the blood of Jesus cleanse me tonight from all unrighteousness. Are you still there, my sister? And the Lord is nudging your heart and saying, you are the one I'm talking to. Have a good plan for you. Why are you hiding your own? Why are you hiding this evil heart? Would you like to come out and obey the Lord tonight and say, Lord, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me, a sinner. Have mercy. The Bible says that sinner, that tax collector, that begged for mercy went away justified. But the Pharisee went away condemned because he was too arrogant to identify with his sin. Will you come out and let the Lord have mercy on you tonight and give you a new heart? We are praying right away. We are praying. And the Lord himself has seen you as you have come out. Those who confess and forsake their sins, they are the ones that will obtain mercy. Those who are ashamed to identify with Christ and his word tonight, he said, I will be ashamed of you when I get to the presence of my Father. Would you like to identify with God tonight and join our sisters who are out here and say, Lord, I'm the one. I'm the one. Have mercy on me. Those of you who are out, please beg God tonight for mercy. God will do what he said he would do. He said, I'm going to change your heart. You can't improve it. I will give you a new heart. Will you open your mouth and say, Lord, forgive me my sins. Change my heart, O Lord. I surrender it to you. He said, daughter, give me your heart. Now practically tell him, Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my heart. Take it away. I give you this corrupt heart, this sinful heart. Take it away, Lord. Give me a new heart. Open your mouth and say it to the Lord. Give me a new heart. Give me a new spirit. I receive that new heart tonight. Ask him to come in. He says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in. He is standing at the door of your heart now. Open the door for him. He said, I want to dwell in you. I don't want to be a visitor. Coming and going. When you sin, you drive me away. But no, I want to dwell in you. I want to make your heart my dwelling place. As you are out here, will you tell him, Lord, I receive you into my heart now. I open the door of my life to you, my entire life. I give you the key. There is nowhere you cannot go inside my life. Be free, Lord, from tonight to dwell in me. Be free to enter any corner of my heart. I give you the key. Come in, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Make my heart your dwelling place. Are you praying that prayer tonight? The Lord is already answering that prayer. Something new is beginning to happen inside. In the twinkle of an eye, the Lord is entering. And he will make your heart his dwelling place. You will become a woman that God can use. We are going to pray right now. As you are lifting up those hands out here, we are praying. Let's pray together. Our Father, we give you thanks tonight that you have been so gracious to us to show us the kind of woman that you are looking for in the nations. Women are precursors for revival. And tonight you have come to get a rich harvest of women that you can use. Tonight, Lord, we thank you for your word to us, that you did not hide it from us, because you are about doing a great work in Southern African nations. Lord, look at these lives that have come out to you, and they did not hide their sins. Look at these lives, oh God, who are not ashamed of identifying with you as you have spoken to them. You have promised, you said, give me your heart, and I will give you a new heart. Tonight I pray, may you give them a new heart in the name of Jesus Christ. May you take away from them the heart of stone. Give them a new heart, a heart that fears God, a heart that is pure, a heart that is blameless. Grant it unto each one of them tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. May you sprinkle your clean water upon them. Let the blood of Jesus cleanse them from every unrighteousness tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. Every sinful act, every sinful habit, everything that has defiled them in your presence, that makes you to push them aside before, tonight we bleed the blood of Jesus. Let there be cleansing in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, that as they have opened their hearts to you, asking you to come in, Lord Jesus, and take your place in their hearts. Come in, Lord, and make their hearts your dwelling place. Come in, Lord, and begin to dwell in them and to live righteously, to live blamelessly. A life that has power to say no to sin. Give them tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. And Lord, is there any of them, Lord, whose sin has opened the door for all kinds of demonic oppression? Whose sin has opened the door for the devil to torment them with any form of sickness? Tonight, as they identify with you tonight, as you have cleansed them from all unrighteousness, every sickness, every demonic oppression, every activity of the devil in any of these lives, we banish it in the name of Jesus Christ. You demons, look at these ones. They have been given a new heart. You have no space in their lives again. We bind you and we cast you out in the name of Jesus Christ. You will have no way into them again to influence, to oppress, to depress in the name of Jesus Christ. Every sin that has caused all kinds of sickness in any of these ones, the Lord has cleansed them from that sin. So you sickness, you have no place again in these bodies that the Lord has bought with a price by his precious blood. So every sickness, I outlaw you from each of these ones. In the name of Jesus Christ, their bodies are hereby sanctified to become a dwelling place for the Most High God, not a dwelling place for sickness. We banish every form of sickness from you. In the name of Jesus Christ, receive your healing. Receive your deliverance. Receive tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is the Lord that makes you whole. It is Jesus who died for you. It is he who has set you free. Be free tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for doing your work. Thank you, Lord, for showing us mercy. Thank you for your compassion towards us. Thank you for choosing that we are the ones you will use in the few days ahead. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Your work that you have started tonight, may you continue it in each of their lives in the name of Jesus Christ. And each one of us in this meeting tonight, we pray that this work you have started, you will perfect it in our lives. When you are looking for women that you will use, Father, we pray that you will find each one of us in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, please, we pray that you will prepare us, oh God, for divine usefulness in the name of Jesus Christ. Blessed be your name, oh God. We will find you. You will find us. You will do your work in us, and it will prosper in each of our lives. We bless and we magnify your name. We thank you and we bless your name. Thank you for hearing us tonight. Thank you that you will do beyond how we know how to ask, for you are the Lord and you are favorably disposed towards us. Thank you for doing it. We bless and we worship you. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen.